lives one day at a time. Kimmy Kim and Elations Radio. They're here to get your day going fine. Kimmy Kim and Elations Radio. Kimmy Kim and Elations Radio. Kimmy Kim and Elations Radio.
And here's your host, Miss Kim Robinson.
By faith and not by sight, in your power. to God. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. We are walking by faith and not by sight. That was opposite by none other than appointed. Amen. Living by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. It's the opposite of what the world is saying in this hour. God bless you all. I truly do thank you for joining us on today. Amen. And I want you to buckle up your seats if you are here with us. Amen. We are ready to hear a word that is going to change you, my God, today. Hallelujah. I believe that we are in such a strategic time, people of God, and people make mockery of the fact that so many are saying that we are living in the last days. Amen. But I want you to know that time is truly shorter than we think. Amen. So we must be about the Father's business. And so I want to say good afternoon to you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I decree this is the day that has been etched out in time, and you are not listening by mistake. You are not listening by mistake or an accident. Amen. As a matter of fact, I believe that this day, this chosen day, this particular day has been appointed. It is an appointed time. Amen. It doesn't matter where you are. He is omnipotent, amen, having unlimited power. He is omnipotent, knowing all things. He is omnipresent, being everywhere at the same time. He knows the times that we are living in, people of God. Job said that, you know the way that I take. So because of that, I know that this, again, is a moment that we should not take lightly. It is not by a mistake. As a matter of fact, for those of you that are Hebrew scholars, you know that there is no word in Hebrew for coincidence. Amen. The Lord said that his word, his plans would prevail. He knows the beginning and the end of all things. So I want to just welcome, hallelujah, you here, my listening audience. This is Shabbat Saturday with Apostle Dawn. Amen. Glory to God. And our guest, our noted guest today, is evangelist, prophetess, anointed, prolific woman of God, Melissa Ross. Amen. We welcome you to Shabbat Saturday. And for those that are joining us, amen, we would ask you to please mute your phones so that you will not disrupt the flow of the Holy Ghost, because we want him to have free course, and we want the people of God to be able to receive without any interruption. So please mute your phone if you are not the speaker of the hour. Glory to God. Today, I am so looking forward to what God is going to do, and so I want you to share, amen, with somebody. Tell them to get on the call. You do not want to miss what the woman of God is about to release, amen, in just a little bit. Prophetess, evangelist, Melissa Ross. And I want to thank you, each and everyone, for just taking time out of your schedule. I know that you have so many other choices, but I believe that this is a mandate. I believe that this is a divine appointment. Amen. And so we will Shabbat our Lord and our God on today. The word says in Revelation 4:11, you are worthy, O Lord our God, to receive glory and honor and power. Hallelujah. You created all things, and by your will they exist and were created. That's why we Shabbat him on today. Hallelujah. Hey, again, this is your host of Shabbat Saturday, Apostle Dawn, and that's what we do here, amen, on Elation Radio, amen. And I want to thank you for tuning in on this very special Shabbat Saturday with our featured guest, evangelist, prophetess, Melissa Ross of Love and Faithfulness Church of Front Royal, West Virginia. I want to thank you for tuning in, because I know, people of God, hallelujah, with our so much noise that is going on around us, amen, so many distractions, my God, today, You really do know that you need to know that you are hearing the voice of Yeshua. And what I can't understand is, and I'm going to share this with you because I always try to be transparent because that is the way the Father made me. Amen? Why is it that every time we get on, and I hear this from other speakers too, when you go live, you got people that think they just got to text you. They just got to text you. They just got to be in communication with you. My God, today. But listen, I want to thank you again for tuning in, all of you. There is a great shaking going on in the heavenly realm, and we, hallelujah, the men and women of God, have been given the authority to speak and say something. And the word released today, amen, is going to bless you. So I pray that you are ready. Glory to God. Your seats are buckled. You're attentive. Glory to God. And your ear is to the radio station. Hallelujah. Prophetess, evangelist, Melissa Ross, are you on the line? Hallelujah.
Hear me?
I can hear you now, woman of God, loud and clear, and I thank you so much for coming on. Hallelujah. Glory
hallelujah.
To God. How
hallelujah,
are you,
hallelujah.
Woman of God?
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father God, for this divine appointment, for this divine moment, Father God. We just thank you, Lord God. And Pastor Don, I've had some technical difficulties trying to get on. So I'm just, you know, praying against any interruptions since we move forward.
Amen. Well, let's go and pray right now, shall we? Hallelujah. Father God,
yeah.
We just take authority over the airwaves,
yes,
right
God.
Now. And we can hear you, woman of God. Hallelujah.
Mm.
Father God, I thank you for the authority that you have given us through your word that says whatsoever
yes.
we bind here on earth is bound in heaven. So we bind up the principality of the airwaves. Hallelujah. We bring everything into subjection to your authority and your rule and your reign. Hallelujah. And we thank you, Lord
thank
God.
You, Lord.
No interference in the name of Yeshua. And Lord, we thank you for those that have gathered here with us. We thank you that they will respect the woman of God in this hour and mute their phones as we have asked them to do. Hallelujah. And that they will follow proper protocol in the name of Yeshua. And Father God, I pray that they will be blessed, that they will be set free, that they will receive deliverance, that they will receive wisdom and an impartation in this hour. Lord God, I thank you that there is a fire stirred up in my belly because I know that you have equipped this woman of God to bring a word in season for your people. And Father God, for that, I give you the praise, the glory, and the honor in the name of Yeshua. And I seal this prayer with the blood. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Woman of God, you are released to go forth. Bless the people of God
hallelujah.
And Shabbat the Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you. I thank you for those that have joined us online right now. I just thank you, woman of God. I am not going to keep you on here long. I've been praying and I've been seeking the Lord. And I know that sometimes, you know, they're probably going to do things a little different right now because I felt led to share a little bit of the teaching that I wrote. And actually, I wrote it like a year ago, and it's kind of ironic that God told me to, you know, reminded me, and I went back and looked at it. A lot of times the Lord gives me a word, and I will write. I keep a notebook of all my writings, and sometimes that word is not released until a later time. And as I was studying and I was looking on social media last night, and I saw a post referencing, and it was talking about those that are ministering in the field of God. How many know that, you know, the field of God is the world, and we are ministers of the gospel. We are his disciples, and what God was showing me, you know, I want to take a look into scripture right now, and that is in Matthew 13, verses 24 and 30, we are sowers in the field of God. And this parable, you know, God really opened it up and gave me revelation to it. And right now in this day and time, we see so many leaders and speakers out there on social media that are turning away and trying to weed out God's field. And it's not our field. We are sowers in the field, but it's God's field. So I wanna just share this word with you. Let me get this up here.
And just repeat that chapter that you're going to, woman of God, for those that are just coming on.
We're going to be looking at Matthew 13, 24, and verses 24 and 30. I felt led to share some of what I learned and the understanding that I was received when I first looked at this, when God first had me look at it, you know. And I actually thought about a garden, since I grew up with a father who always planted a garden, and when I was young. So let us consider that God has a garden, a spiritual field, and what our part is in that spiritual garden, that field. If you ever take, or if you go and look up later and look at a picture of what is like the what it a darnel looks like and a head of wheat looks like, these two things, these two plants, you cannot distinguish the difference between them until it's almost the very end time of the harvest. Before that stage, these plants look almost identical. To the church, congregation, Corinth, the Apostle Paul wrote, "You are God's field, you are God's building," 1 Corinthians 3:9. Throughout this passage, that passage, Paul makes it very clear that through so he or another minister may have sown seed or tended and watered. It was God who gave the increase. God controls his field and what it produces for harvest in 1 Corinthians 3, 5-9. But back to Matthew. This is both comforting and encouraging. Let me tell you why. While growing next to wheat, tares cannot be distinguished from the real wheat. It's not until near the time of the harvest you can discern which of the two is the real item. God has opened many doors for me to share my testimony and speak on faith and healing and to work alongside the mighty people of God that are truly doing his will for his kingdom purpose. However, this calling has also brought me in contact with all kinds of people and personalities. Though they have had many backgrounds, motives, problems, and like, one thing brought us together. Our past, some of those I've known, no longer hold to their faith. As we saw and as you see in the parable of the sower and the seed, some allow the seed of the gospel to be choked out by the cares of life and the persecutions of this world. Some with whom I once walked there have fallen into that category. But with most, I've never foresaw that they would ever fall by the wayside, nor did they. We appeared the same to each other. We professed the same goals and beliefs. But my work in ministry has taught me another lesson. It is that even though we are in fellowship of the same church, it may be for different reasons. And the parable of the wheat and the tares adds another dimension to our understanding of the seed sown in that field. The tares that are among the wheat. Christ gave this parable immediately following the parable of the sower. And notice what he said. Another parable he put forth to them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sows good seed in his field. But while men slept, enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the grain had sprouted and produced the crop, then the tares also appeared. So the servants of the owner came and said to him, Sir, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have tares? And he said to them, And an enemy has done this. The servant said to him, Do you want us then to go and gather them up? But he said, No. Least while you gather up the tares, you also uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at that time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, First gather together the tares and behind them and bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. Matthew 13:24-30. This parable is similar to the previous one, only that we have the sowing of seed. But that is where the similarity ends. Every other element holds a different meaning and takes us to a sobering conclusion about God's seed and those who are in it. A tare is a plant that commonly grows in fields of grain. And although it looks similar to the edible grain, it isn't suitable for food. In fact, many feel the specific tare or weed referred to in this parable is the darnel, a poisonous weed that is very similar to appearance to wheat. While growing next to the stalk of wheat, the darnel cannot be distinguished from the real wheat. It is not until near the time of harvest when the wheat comes into air or sprouts its fruit that you can discern with on a man. The field is the world, the good seeds are the sons of the kingdom, but the tares are the sons of the wicked one. The enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are the angels. Therefore, as the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all things that offend and those who practice lawlessness, and will cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth, and the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears to hear, let them hear. Matthew 13:37-43. God has a field, and it's defined here as the entire world. There is a divine meaning and purpose being worked out here. God is guiding history and mankind to the end that will fulfill his purpose. The parable is showing two different in the world, and it provides understanding as to why there is evil. God plants good seed that becomes his children of the kingdom. Satan, wicked one, plants those who are his offspring. Because the tares and the weeds look alike, it is virtually impossible to determine by sight which is which. That is why God tells his servants to let them both grow to harvest when the difference will become apparent, of course. The Lord knows who are his. Not our place, saints of God, to determine whose are his and who is not of him. Only God knows the heart of people, and only God can see the heart. 2 Timothy 2:19, are the sons of the wicked one among them truly evil people? No. The parable tells us that they look and act similar to the sons of the kingdom. You cannot tell them apart until we repent and turn to God. We are all walking according to the course of the world, according to the prince of the power of the air, spirit who now works in the sons by mood and attitude. Until we understand this and actively resist his evil spirit at work, we can unwittingly be his agent. Satan is the god of this age, and he keeps everyone deceived. 2 Corinthians 4:4 and Revelation 12:9. But in he can infiltrate the closest quarters of God's people. Jesus' words to this effect to serve as a warning. Let God sort his field, kindness and fairness and gentleness. God who knows the heart, something I cannot always discern, expects us to do this. One of the key thoughts in this parable is the owner telling his servant to not go through that field, cutting out those that they thought were chosen. Then it is a dangerous action. I have worked with many people who express interest in God and desire to live right. You learn to give them the benefit of the doubt. When they sin, it provides the opportunity to help them get back on their feet spiritually. People may at times like a cherub, but be a son. They may act or appear to be a cherub, but be a son of the kingdom. And people may act like a son of the kingdom, but be a cherub. I could always tell, or anything. One of the lessons I took from this parable is to let God do the work of discerning who are his and who are not. Not only was it not my role, but I didn't have all the tools for the job, that's for sure. A worker in God's field has to adopt a position of vigilant toleration that watches like a shepherd over God's people and teaches sound doctrine from the Bible along with a gentle oversight. Treating people fairly and kindly always had good results. You know, when Jesus was, in the 3 years of Jesus' ministry on the earth, and he was ministering to the people, he was doing it out of love and compassion. And it's something that in this hour that the saints of God need to seek God and pour that love and compassion for all people. You know, he says to lay them to love our enemies, even those that have risen up against us, even those that shun us or rise against us. We are to show them love. We are the servants and compassion. We are that their soul moves. That their soul may be saved. That their soul may be saved. You know, there are times, but treating people fairly, as I said, has always had busy thoughts. I mean, there might be some problems. Some of it sometimes, though, in the ministry, may let problems go on longer than, and yes. Sometimes there's action that needs to be taken to separate some people that have wrong motives away from the members. But Apostle Paul advised us to be patient. If the servants of the field owner have rampaged through the field, tearing up the good wheat along with the tares, what kind of mess would have been created? Good crops would have been prevented from coming to maturity and bearing fruit. So it is with working in God's spiritual field and teaching his church, it is possible to harm, even destroy the good in any effort to weed out the tares. It's God's timing. God says to let them grow together into the harvest. The end of the age and the coming of Jesus Christ, and he will make a distinction as only he can. We are servants of God. We are to minister the gospel. We are to win souls for the kingdom of God. It is God's job to judge people, not ours. He is the only just and right God. The judge, he is the only just and right. He is the only one. We cannot know the hearts of men. Only God can. God says, let them grow together into the harvest. The end of the age and coming of Jesus Christ, he will make distinction as only he can. Christ says that any who offend and practice lawlessness will be gathered and cast into the furnace of fire. Judgment is difficult and hard at times, but that is one of the lessons here. There is a time of judgment determined on the world. Those who are agents of Satan engaged in different acts of evil will face judgment. The modern world doesn't like to hear a word like judgment because judgment implies a fair standard, laws, and absolutes, both morally and ethically. But God says there is coming a time of judgment that will deal with lawlessness and all right. God's judgment. And it is a wonderful, and that is a wonderful topic because God judges them perfect. God judges them perfect righteousness in his time. We need to take God and his working very seriously. I don't want to be a terror, someone who impersonates the real thing. The world is to show themselves the real thing. In this case, the real thing is a genuine Christian planted by God in his field. It is not my role, nor is it yours, to figure out who or cares to obey. Let God do that. Perhaps the main reason that this parable is here is to sound a warning to all of us who profess Christian attitudes, to examine ourselves, to make sure that we are in the true faith, following the teachings of Christ and the building on a right foundation. Jesus learned that he likened those who heard his teaching and actually did them to one who built his house on a rock, to thereby withstand the winds and gales. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. It is wise to hear the teachings and let it move us to God's fear to have in the light that are sound and faithful. We see so many people today on social media, and my heart is overwhelmed. You will never look into the eyes of another soul, I don't care who they are, what they've done, that God does not love, that they were to die for too, that they have a purpose. We as Christians and we as servants of God, we have to do what is right, even when we're wrong. Even when we're wrong. It's not our place, brothers and sisters, to bring judgment on people. In Romans, I'm going on here, in Romans 12:17, 12, verses 17 to 1, you know, it says, recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lies in you, live peacefully with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will pay, says the Lord. Therefore, if thy enemy hunger, feed him. If thy thirst, give him a drink, for in doing so, shall he hold the fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil by overcoming evil with good. I am speaking on this subject. Some of you out there have obviously, you know, have suffered traumatic loss. People that have spoken up against you, spoken against, you know, the body of Christ. But did they not do that to you? And you may or may have lived daily under a barrage of verbal and emotional attacks, struggle with bitterness or for being betrayed. But we need to practice with the manner, we need to practice now with the minor wrongs that we are suffering so that we'll be prepared for the major wrongs that are coming. We as Christians, I do believe that we are going to face persecution. I'm like, see Christians being persecuted in other countries, but we've never had it really here in the U.S., in the nation, in this nation, but we are about to. When people wrong us, we still have to show the love and compassion of God. We have to do right, even when we're wrong. Even when we're wrong, our aim must be to do right, even when we're wrong. We people are watching us. We people are looking at us. They are looking at the body of Christ. They are looking at the church. And I believe, and I truly, truly believe in my soul, my spirit tells me that the way the like being imagers of Christ and doing and speaking to the people and showing them love and compassion. This doesn't mean you compromise the word of God. This means that you speak the word of God, but you speak it with love and compassion, as Jesus said. Father God, we have a way and the way that we should respond when we are wrong. Paul says that three times, Father God, just give me guidance here. Give me guidance. The scripture says that we should not repay another with evil for evil, that always seek after that which is good for one another, for all people. Thank you, Bota. You know, I want to share, you know, there's been times and instances in my own life where the pain and hurt that has been inflicted on me, I wanted to respond and inflict the same hurt and pain by pointing out their faults as well. I would speak back sometimes in bitterness because of my own hurt. But that is not how the Lord wants us to respond to the people and respond to the world. But we are seeing it more and more and more. We are seeing it more and more. Loving your enemies, overcoming evil with good. Take young people today. That, you know, if we go out and begin to win souls for the kingdom, we have a kingdom purpose, and our purpose is to win souls. And we have to do it out of love and compassion. Love and compassion. That we are to repay. It is not our place to go to the field and say that this one is bad and this one's not, and judging and picking people out of the field. This will be done by the reapers, and God will judge them, not us. And that time has come because the harvest is ready. But we as servants of God need to prepare ourselves with compassion and to do it with love and compassion. And that's all I keep hearing in my spirit, is that it's to be done with love and compassion. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you. You would search our hearts, Father God. Search our hearts, empty us, Lord God, the things that are not pleasing to you, Lord God. Empty us, Lord God. And fill us, Father God, with all of you and none of us, Father God. Lead, God, and direct us, Father God, that we may, Father God, have a heart full of compassion and love for your people, Lord God. For your people, Father God. Give them a heart full of love, compassion, and wisdom.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. There is such a strong presence of the Holy Spirit on this call right now, and I believe that this is a word, a very sober word, but a word nonetheless that is needed now that we need to take a posture, a position. Amen. And I believe the word specific was very specific. Amen. Distinguishing those that are the wheat and the tares. Amen. And the question is, which are you? Hallelujah. I mean, the discussion regarding the darnel, which is a very poisonous type of wheat, of tare. Amen. But it's small enough, amen, to mimic the weed. Glory to God. But yet it's very poisonous. Hallelujah. And it made me think about how is it that we are, and I say we, I mean the body of Christ, how is it that we are not so immersed, so discerning, not so connected that we cannot distinguish the counterfeit, the impersonator? Hallelujah. And subsequently, many, many are being led astray. I know that wasn't what the woman spoke on, but it just made me think of that one note. Hallelujah. How, you know, Judas had a relevant position that I know. Amen. But Judas, our Lord and our Messiah, making a conscious decision. He could have called him out anytime. He was very discerning. He recognized him. Amen. Hallelujah. But as you mentioned, there is a time of judgment, woman of God. Hallelujah. And he knew that Judas was needed. Glory to God. And it wasn't for anyone else to know it but him. And at the appointed time, it was revealed. Amen. You know, the first thing I think of is that though we at times may be fooled, God is never fooled. Amen. And through even my own experience with such people, I have learned to know the truth of God from his word, challenge his truth and actions. But he said that his plan would prevail. Glory to God. He said that his truth would make us free. Glory to God. And he said that his truth is the incorruptible seed. Hallelujah. It is forever established, my God, today. And in the end, he will send his angels to separate the real from the false. Hallelujah. But we, as servants of God, we search for him with all of our heart and our soul. We give him a full commitment. We, as the woman of God referred to us, we're the wheat who are going to be tossed into the barn at the end. Hallelujah. Because we are seeking him with all of our heart and our soul. Glory to God. I want to thank you for this word that was released today. My God, today, I want to thank you. I know that most of us, some of us maybe, are going through the refiner's fire. Glory to God. And some of us have this burning inside of us, the burning of the Holy Ghost that is burning off everything that does not bring him glory, that we are required to purify our hearts in this hour. My God, today, woman of God, thank you. Thank you so much for that word. And we Shabbat our awesome God. And I encourage you, listening audience, to seek the Lord today if you do not know him. Amen. A psalmist by the name of Appointed said, give me a heart that is soft as a whisper. Hallelujah. A heart, hallelujah, that wants to be transformed. A heart that wants to be used by the Father. Glory to God. Well, the Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart. And it says, and of a contrite spirit. And those who have a broken heart and a contrite spirit, amen, are willing to do anything and everything that God asks of them without resistance, without resentment. Amen. Hallelujah. We cease doing things our way. Hallelujah.
and we have a heart that is submitted, a heart that is given true repentance. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Prophetess Ross. This word has provoked me. It's provoked the listeners through the Holy Spirit. Amen. To move to a place of true repentance where we do not judge our brother, but look at ourselves, my God, today. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Move to a place where we cry out and give our heart that is not comfortable with being complacent and accept the place and the process He is molding you and giving you, a heart that is truly humbled, a heart that wants Him, that needs Him, hallelujah, like the air you breathe. Thank you, woman of God. And if anything, I pray that this has provoked you, oh my God, today, provoked you to run into the presence of God, hallelujah, so that you may be fit for the Master's use, hallelujah, so that you may not be tossed with the tares, my God, today. Pray this word will propel you into that place that God is calling you to in this hour. This word is so needed. And I want to thank you, woman of God, for being so transparent with us. Hallelujah. Listen, people of God, my God, today, there's no doubt what God has released, hallelujah, or what he wants you to do in this season. We are at our place where Yeshua is calling our hearts whole, partly, completely, hallelujah, not part of us, but all of us. And Father God, I thank you that you will continue to minister a mighty deliverance in the hearts of those that will leave this broadcast and not forget the word that has been released, but those even more so that will listen to the rebroadcast, hallelujah. We Shabbat the Lord. And we expect a great move of God in your lives during this season. We decree and declare his mighty acts, hallelujah, because he is Yahweh, Elohim, Almighty God, all-knowing, hallelujah. And in this hour, I would implore you to align yourself to be in position. Be the wheat, hallelujah, that will stand strong and not fret or doubt or waver, hallelujah, will not worry, hallelujah, glory to God. People, we Shabbat Yeshua for this spiritual breakthrough that is taking place now for you, if you receive it, hallelujah. Begin to believe that he can take you from where you are now to where you are to be and fulfill your purpose, amen, and your calling. Abba, Father, fill this broadcast with your glory, that those who are under the sound of my voice now and later on the rebroadcast experience a great manifestation of your power and your presence. Touch the life and nature of God within them, Yeshua. Change the heart of men and women that are listening. And I decree and declare that that change is taking place now, people of God. I want to say thank you for stopping by for another Shabbat Saturday. Thank you, Dr. Timmy Kim Robinson, and Elation Radio, iHeart, Spreaker Radio, and YouTube for this platform and for God's people. I pray the Lord will continue to bless you. I pray that he will bless you. Take hold of this word. Examine yourself. Be in right standing with him, because time is shorter than you could possibly imagine. Continue to bless him. Hallelujah. Father God, I pray that you will, hallelujah, bless them. Open up their understanding. Remove, Lord God, the crustacean on the eyes of their spirit man, that they may see and hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying in this hour. in the name of Yeshua. And again, I want to thank you. Thank you. Thank you for joining us this Shabbat Saturday. Thank you, prophetess, evangelist Melissa Ross, my God, today. And all of you, please come back next Saturday, 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 12 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, for another Shabbat Saturday at this great station. Again, thank you, prophetess Melissa Ross, my God, today. Woman of God, you just don't know. You blessed me. You blessed us with this life-changing word. It is a life-changing word, my God, today. And there will be a rebroadcast. People of God, go back and listen to it again. Hallelujah. It is a noteworthy word to the body of Christ today. And again, thank you, Dr. Kimmy Kim, our producer, for your example and for your heart and for your love. May the Lord God continue to use you, great woman of God. Now, please close us out. Shalom, everyone.
There's a place that I wanna go, where the sun is always shining, folks are always smiling. Go a place where crying is unheard of and dying ain't even thought of. Oh, a place where there's no color of skin, you won't find no sin. Oh, a place. And I wanna get there. Yeah, I'm gonna get there one day. I wanna get there. I'm gonna get there one day. Get there one day.